Wow.
Well, hello. My name is Ed Johnson. I'm the Director of Science at the Staten Island Museum. Also teach geology at the College of Staten Island. And we're here today looking at the emergence of the 17-year cicadas in Clove Lakes Park. And we're excited about this because it's something that happens only once every 17 years on Staten Island. And we have some of our subjects right here. And so these guys have been underground for 17 years. They look like this when they're underground. That's a nymph. And then they're marking the seasons over as time goes by. At the end of the 17th year, when the ground gets warm enough, they tunnel towards the surface, come out, crawl up any vertical object like this sapling tree here, and the back will split open. You see some of these have transformed already. Turn that up so you can see that. So they've already split out of their skins. The adult comes out. It's all white at first. And then eventually it'll darken up and look like this. So we have a lot of adults here. I have a male right here. They produce a song, and they have these little sound producing organs called timbals, a little kind of whitish thing right there that has muscles attached to it, so they can expand and contract those and make the familiar pharaoh type sound. But we don't hear that now because it's kind of cool right now, so they're not singing. Only the males sing. So they hope to attract females, and that's really what it's all about. They want to attract females so they can mate, females can lay eggs and carry on the species. So in 17 years there'll be more little cicadas crawling around. Now you notice I'm handling this guy pretty freely. There's nothing to be afraid of. They can't bite, right? There's no stinger, they can't sting. They really can't do anything to harm you. So they're completely harmless, and they'll just crawl around on you like that. They don't hurt the plants at all. They just suck a little bit of tree sap while they're alive. And when they're underground, they're sucking on sap from tree roots. And as adults, they push through the same thing, just on plant stems. They just suck a little sap out of it for nutrition. Well, they don't eat the leaves or anything else like that. They don't hurt your plants. So they're pretty harmless and they're beneficial. When they're out, everything eats them. You know, birds, mammals, fish, dogs and cats, squirrels. Everything eats them, and then when they die, and they'll, you know, you have these millions of little dead cicadas piling up all over the place. their decomposing bodies, they add nutrients to the soil, so kind of like payback. From sucking sap for 17 years, then their bodies will serve to give nutrients to the trees that they were kind of feeding off of all that time. So,
how long do they live for when they emerge?
Yeah, once they come out, they live for a few weeks. Each individual cicada may be like 3 weeks as an adult, and that's it. So by the end of June, they're all dead. The eggs have been laid, and the adults all die, and that's it for another 17 years. And by about the end of July or so, the eggs will hatch out. The young will fall to the ground, and they're really tiny, but they're the size of a rice grain. The young will fall to the ground, and they'll immediately burrow down into the ground about a foot or a foot and a half down, so they're below the frost line. And then that's it for 17 years. They'll just stay down there. And we like these guys. The Staten Island Museum has the largest collection of cicadas in North America in its collection, and we have the second largest in the world. So we're proud of that, and there he goes. Didn't go too far, though. And so we like to celebrate the cicadas and everything about them.
So how many do you think there are in total?
I mean, on Staten Island, there's probably millions. I mean, I think that's probably a pretty safe bet. There's probably millions emerging across the island, mostly along the south shore. Clove Lakes Park is about as far north as you're going to find them on the island. And if you live in New York City, you have to come to Staten Island to see them. You're not going to see these anyplace else. You're not going to get them in Central Park and Prospect Park or anywhere, really. You have to come to Staten Island if you want to see a good emergence like this. Okay, so we're in Clove Lakes Park still, and on my finger I have a nymph that's just come out of the ground, and he's getting ready to transform soon. But what's really interesting is over here on this poison ivy leaf, we have another nymph that's starting to transform. So you see the back is split open, and this white adult is coming out. You know, the wings are all shriveled up now, but once it's fully emerged, it'll pump fluid into those wings to expand them. So then, after a few hours, it will look like this one. That's a fully mature adult. So you got the nymph, you got the transforming nymph, now you have the adult right here.
So do they fly high up, or they just stay near the trees and bushes?
Okay, they can fly, they're not great flyers, so they'll mean the males, actually, and females will fly up to the treetops. That's where the males will be singing from. And that's about as high as they go, really. And they don't really go too far either. So the ones that are hatching out here in Cove Lakes Park are going to stay right around here. They're not going to travel off the island. They're not going to fly over to Manhattan or anyplace else. They're going to stay pretty much local right here.
Do they ever fight amongst each other, or they just will live in harmony?
They don't really fight. They're not violent insects. But at best, two males might compete for a female, but it'll just be like through their songs, like, and just trying to establish who's dominant. But they're not gonna, like, they can't bite, so they can't harm each other.
Mm-hmm.
So
the nymphs, do they lay the eggs?
Oh no, the adults lay the eggs.
Oh, the adults.
Yeah, the adults. Like, let me see. This one actually is a female. So this one, so when the time is right, the female will land on a branch,
mm-hmm,
and make slits in it. She actually saw little slits into the end of the branch with an ovipositor, which is this little organ in the bottom right here. So she'll saw slits into the branch and lay eggs in there. And she can lay as many as 600 eggs. So when she does that, you know, her job is done, basically. And those eggs, you know, will incubate in that branch tip until about the end of July. Then they will hatch out, and they'll be tiny little nymphs, you know, rice grain size.
And what do they do once they hatch out?
Once they hatch out, the little nymphs will fall to the ground, because they're up in a tree someplace, so they're just going to fall to the ground, but they're so light that it doesn't hurt them.
Mm-hmm.
And then they immediately dig under this, they'll dig down into the ground, you know, about a foot to a foot and a half. They have to be below the frost line. So they'll just dig down, find a nice tree root, and start sucking sap. And that's what they do for the next 17 years.
Are there different types of cicadas?
And we have, on Staten Island right now, we have these so-called the periodical cicadas hatching out. And within that group, there's three different species. They're all coming out at the same time, and they all look basically the same. But they have different songs. So they have a different song, which you can tell them by their songs. If you have one in your hands, they do look a little bit different. So if you're practiced, you can tell them apart from each other. So yeah, you can tell them apart. This way, this nymph trying to crawl up into my pocket here. So these are all gone by the end of June. But then, mm-hmm, in July, we have what we call the annual or dog day cicadas coming out. And those are the ones you hear buzzing up in the treetops all summer long. So those are different. They probably have like a 3 to 7 year life cycle. And there's enough overlapping broods where you hear them every summer. You're always going to hear some. But these guys, only once every 17 years.
Are they in the south also?
Yeah, actually, you only have these periodical 17-year cicadas only in the east and the southeast, and in the Midwest as well. But basically west of the Mississippi River. And actually, in the south, you have a 13-year brood. So instead of every 17 years, every 13 years. So that's a little bit different. But except there's one brood west of the Mississippi, everything else is really east of the Mississippi. And you don't really have this anyplace else in the world. You don't have this mass emergence of cicadas anyplace else in the world except for the eastern United States. That's really unusual. It makes them unique.
Do you know how old they are living on this earth?
No, I don't. I mean, they go back. Cicadas, fossil cicadas have been found at least as far back as the Cretaceous in the Santana Formation in Brazil, which is about 65 million years old. So it's like late Cretaceous. So they found them at least back that far.
Are they in Brazil also?
Yeah, cicadas are found all over the world.
Oh, I see.
Yeah. except the only continent they're not found on is Antarctica, for obvious reasons. But all the other continents, and in fact, the United States has a very high diversity of cicadas. We have lots of different kinds here.
Okay, so there are many in this area. Mm-hmm. It's just a little chilly out, so yeah. They're resting right now.
Yeah, it's a little cool right now. It got overcast today, so they're not singing. They don't like cool, overcast, cloudy days. And they see you have a nymph on your shoulder right now.
Oh yeah, I see him.
So they think we're trees because we're standing still at one spot. I'll get that one for you.
Okay.
They think we're trees, so they're just climbing up us, looking for a nice spot to transform. I'll put these guys down back so they won't get eaten by birds.
Okay.
Hopefully they can transform tonight and be safe. Any more on me?
I don't know. They're all over.
I think I'm good.
Okay. How about me? I can't see.
You look pretty good.
All right.
Yeah, I think you're okay.
Okay. Any last words about the cicadas and about Staten Island people? As you were saying, they were a little worried about them getting bit.
Yeah.
And
I'd say you should get outside and enjoy them because they'll be gone all too soon. And I'm giving a number of cicada walks through the Staten Island Museum on Sundays. So you should come out on the walk. You get to see them up close and personal. You see that they really are interesting and harmless insects. And I said that they'll be gone all too soon, and then you have to wait another 17 years for them to come back. So I'd say get out there and enjoy them. They are just a natural wonder that we should be celebrating. It's something that's, you know, special about Staten Island.
Okay, if people want information about the tours, can they call the museum and see when you're giving the tours?
Yeah, just call the Staten Island Museum and they have all the information about when the tours are scheduled, yeah.
Basically on a Sunday?
Yeah, I've been doing it mostly on Sundays, yeah. Oh. I have one on a Saturday, but mostly Sundays.
Okay, well.
And it's a limited time because, you know, once the end of June comes, that's it. No more.
Okay. Well, we're going to say goodbye to the little cicadas now and hopefully we'll see them again. Whoa! They're dropping from the trees. Okay, I thank you.
Thank you. I have a few in my hands here. They're kind of hard to corral. But there they are. And there they go. Always looking for the high points.
Okay, and where are the other ones there that are coming out of the shell?
Now we have a couple more that are transforming. So look at this one over here, and another one up there. So there, and then, and then one down below. So it's interesting to see that usually they wait, and there's another one over there too. Usually they wait until twilight to do this, but it's so kind of dark and overcast, I guess they're getting a jump start on it. And over here, here's one that's completely out, and you see the wings are kind of crumply, so he has to pump fluid into those wings to make them, you know, full cicada size, the full adult size wings, and then it has to wait until he darkens up, until his skin gets hard, then he'll be ready to fly. But that one's just come out, he's completely emerged from the shell, just has to like kind of pump those wings up now. This is also when they're good to eat. If you want to eat them, usually you want to get them, you know, just emerged so they're nice and tender.
Okay. And have you eaten any of them?
Yes, I have.
And you're alive?
Yes, I'm alive. I live to tell.
Okay. But did you just eat them or did you cook them?
They were prepared.
Oh, okay.
And they were adults. They weren't young ones. They were adults. And they were prepared. They were like coated in panko breadcrumbs and fried, sauteed in olive oil. And they were good. They ate a bunch of them.
Okay.
He probably landed on me again. Oh. There's another nymph on me. Yeah, they're full of surprises. Oh. I hear them. Now, Pat, look over here. I want to show you something. Now, look at this. These are all exit holes. So this is where, you know, the nymphs were down there. They've been down there for 17 years. And time was right, so they all tunneled upwards. This is what you see. It looks like somebody shot a machine gun into the ground. These are all the exit holes created by the nymphs as they came up to the surface. And over here underneath the tree, you can see all the shells from the ones that transform. So you got piles of empty, these are all empty shells right here. So you have piles of empty shells from ones that transformed. Right?
So they're out here somewhere.
Yeah, they're out there up in the treetop. But now look at this. Look at, you got all these nymphs here that are marching up the tree. I'm here, there. And they'll just climb up. They'll climb. Some start transforming only about 2 feet off the ground. Other ones I've seen go up as high as 20 or 30 feet before they finally stop and will start transforming. And you see a lot of them have used this tree. You see all these shells on the leaves. So those are all empties. So they've already transformed into their adult form.
Okay, and do you think once the eggs are laid, will they go in the same holes or around the same area?
Not the same hole, but this. So we got to figure anything that gets laid in this tree here, they're going to fall down and pretty much in the same area. So they'll just tunnel downwards.
Okay. Oh, yeah, they're all in the leaves.
Yeah.
Oh, look, they're going up the tree.
Yeah, look at them all. It's like you got a regular march going on. I don't want to step on them here. You got a regular little march going on. Look at that.
So at one point they stop.
Yeah, at some point, known only to them, like why, but they'll stop finally. I guess when they feel it coming on, they'll stop. I see. And then they'll stop and they'll start to transform.
Okay. Cicadas.
Yes.
Okay.
Okay, so, Pat, take a look at this. This is really interesting. You have a whole army of them coming up this tree. And there's a lot on this side. I mean, this tree is covered with them. This is a beech tree. And cicadas in general like hardwood trees. So oaks, beech, sweet gum, birch trees. And they'll climb any tree, but they seem to prefer the hardwoods over. They don't really go for evergreens that much, but the hardwood trees they love. And this is a beech tree, and there's a whole little army of them climbing up.
And they'll just go to where they feel it's comfortable.
Yeah, I guess whenever the urge comes to start transforming, they'll stop, and they'll start to, you know, this skin in the back splits open, and they'll start coming out.
Speaking with you, Ed.
Good talking to you. And meanwhile, I got another nymph crawling into my pocket, so I'm gonna put him on a tree over here just so he can transform in peace, hopefully. So I'm gonna put him over here.
There we go.
All right, good. I'm gonna check my. Make sure I don't have anything else crawling into my pocket. So I think I'm good now.
It's got to be new.
Hmm. It's nice. They give you a sense of the whole trail system. It's cool.
Don't worry about that. That's not going to happen.
Well, I think that's a question that's going to be hard to answer.
Yes.
Okay, well, so welcome again to the Staten Island Museum Cicada Citizen Science Walk. And we're doing a few things today. Well, we're in High Rock Park. So as you can hear, there's lots of cicadas calling up in the background. And so we'll be walking around, giving you general cicada information. Also, I'm going to have some things to pass out to you to help you identify the different kinds of cicadas that are calling now. But it's not just one species, right? We have three different species that all come out together. And they all look alike, but they can be told apart. But the big thing is they have a different song. So the ones you're hearing right now, the ones called Major Cicada septendecim. That's the overwhelmingly most common species on the island. That's what we'll be hearing most of today. But there's two other ones I hear in lesser amounts that have different songs. So, and they also look different. So I think what I'll do, I'll give out, I have some handouts for you. So I only have 20 of these made up. I didn't know I was going to have this many people. So I guess if just the adults take them, we'll be in good shape. So
we could all share one.
You can kind of share them.
That's arguable.
Like a teenager.
That's arguable. A bug, done.
You want one?
Yes.
Thank you. Right next near Lake George.
Let's try to figure out which one it is out of the three. Let's see. Let's look at it. Let's try to figure out which one it is.
You think it's the first? All come out together.
What is the red spot?
Like
just passing coming down. Yeah, that's what they say.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, just the ones we have just right now, just
17. Everybody's attention over here. So if you have your sheet, you see we have three different species of cicadas here. Unfortunately, they don't have common names. We have to use our scientific names. As I said, the ones you hear right now is the top one. That's Major Cicada septendecim. And they have that pharaoh call you hear, which you just kind of hear a constant drone because you have, you know, probably thousands and thousands of them all calling together. So you just get that constant drone in the background. So that's the most common one that we'll be seeing most of today.
Singing.
However, we'll be listening for Major Cicada castanet, a second one, which has a completely different call. It's some clicks and then a buzz. So it sounds like click, 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 zhizh. Like that, so very distinctive. And we heard those down in Long Pond this morning. I heard them along Rockland Avenue. I was coming over here before. I heard a few spots on Rockland Avenue. I could hear them from the car window. So we'll be listening for them up here. The third one is the rare one, septendecula, which is just some clicks, some buzzes, and some more clicks. It sounds like it's trying to get started, but never quite makes it. Go click, 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 click. So it never really quite takes off. So we'll be listening for these as we walk around the park here. Now for the citizen science part, like what is citizen science? That's where we use regular people such as yourselves to gather data, and so scientists can kind of notice trends and things like that. So for instance, we have what we call the Christmas bird count. Every year, every December, I have a group of 40 or 45 people who will go out on one particular day and count birds. That's every bird they see. At night we gather at the Staten Island Museum, report results. Those get sent to National Audubon Society, which compiles all the results from all over the country to see if we can notice any different trends in bird populations. And if you can just go to the Bird Source website, so you can see that. You can see all the results for Staten Island and every place else in the country. So it's somewhat similar. We're going to be collecting data, or you can collect data on your own and send it in on the reverse side to magicicada.org website. You just fill out the form on their website, report your cicadas, and that goes into their database and helps scientists figure out, just mapping the cicadas, where they are and kind of how abundant they are in different spots. I was trying to figure out a way that people could actually count cicadas. I couldn't come up with any really meaningful way to do this. I would say, you know, right now you're hearing thousands or probably tens of thousands calling from the immediate vicinity here. And we might see some areas later on. We have exit holes in the ground, so you can get an idea of how many come up in one given spot. So it's really difficult to estimate numbers. When all this first started back in May, there were a lot of internet reports with scientists estimating, you know, in the billions or even a trillion.
Oh,
coming out throughout the whole extent of Brood 2, which goes from upstate New York down to North Carolina. So those numbers aren't really based on anything real solid. Those are estimates. I would say on Staten Island as a whole, you probably will have in the millions coming out. So for the whole range of brood too, in the billions is probably not unreasonable. I don't know about a trillion. So that's an awful lot of cicadas, but so in the billions, I could see that over the whole extent of the range. So I said these come out from as far north as Germantown, New York, and down the Hudson, Staten Island, but not the rest of New York City, not Long Island, but yes, New Jersey, Pennsylvania, Connecticut, and then Virginia, North Carolina, and a tiny bit of Georgia. Now the thing is, there's a lot of some misconception, but they're not going to be out everywhere in that range. They have what's called a patchy distribution. So like even on Staten Island, there's a lot right here. There was a lot in Long Pond Park. There was a lot in Bucks Hollow. So Blue Heron Park, Conference House Park, but other parts of the island, you have nothing. Like I live in Westerly. There's nothing there. Not a single one. So a lot on North Shore of the island, you have nothing at all. Port Richmond, Mariners Harbor, there's just nothing there at all. But other parts, especially in the southern part, from Great Kills down to Tottenville, there's a lot of action. So they have a patchy distribution. Some areas you have a lot, some you have none at all.
What's the is there a reason for
that? I guess the habitat preference, they like mature woodlands with lots of hardwood trees. I've seen lots of perfectly good habitat with nothing in it, so you really can't tell where they're going to be. And they really don't move around much. So wherever you have them now, that's where you get them next time, 17 years from now. But like people always ask me, how come they're not in Central Park? But you have lots of trees, you have lots of woods there. You have to remember that Central Park was largely completely landscaped in the mid-19th century by Frederick Law Olmsted and Calvert Vaux. They basically landscaped that whole park. So they cut down a lot of trees, they moved things around, they did a lot of work down there. So it looks natural now, but it's had 150 years to kind of regrow and repair itself. So, but it really is heavily disturbed in a manicured landscape. Same with Prospect Park. So, but Staten Island, a lot of these woodlands have been untouched for hundreds of years. So they're still pretty much in their natural state. So you do get the cicadas, you're coming back, coming every year. And they're also not going to fly too far, so they're not going to fly from Manhattan, from Staten Island over to Manhattan or from Staten Island over to Brooklyn. They're going to pretty much stay where they are right now. Like the ones in High Rock are pretty much going to stay right in this area. They're not going to fly off to other parts of the island.
Does anyone have any idea how long they've been regenerating?
You got to figure cicadas have been here probably for at least the last, I'm going to say 7 or 8,000 years. You got to figure up to about 10, 12,000 years ago, Staten Island was covered by a thick sheet of ice called the Wisconsin Glacier. Once that retreated, the climate started to moderate. So give it a few thousand years to kind of get more temperate. And then they could have, I assume that they moved up from the south. They expanded their range somehow from the south and now are here. And so they've probably been here for about the last, I'm going to guess, 7, 8,000 years. And, we've been a lot more before. If you could be here, say 500 years ago, it would have been a lot more. It would have been probably been a lot covered a lot more of the islands. But over time, woodlands get cut down, paved with asphalt, you put houses up, put roads in, so you lose a lot of habitat.
Has there been an attempt to bring cicadas to Central Park and let them?
Not that I know of, because you'd have to transport literally thousands for that to work. And even then, if you don't have a certain critical number, the birds get all of them.
Okay.
Once they start to emerge, the birds just get them. So you really need a certain critical number that where it doesn't matter how many of the birds eat, there's always going to be a lot left over to carry on. So why don't we start walking around a little bit, and I'll be telling you cicada stuff like along the way. Oh, sure. This is, I just picked this one off a branch, and this is the common species, Septendecin, but this is a male, And he's being kind of quiet right now, but I wanted to show you the sound-producing organs. So if I just kind of push his wing to the side, you'll see that little kind of grayish-white membrane right there. That's called a timbal. And it's almost like a drum head with muscles running through it. And the cicada can expand and contract those muscles very rapidly, and that's what makes the song. And the abdomen is largely hollow, so that acts like a resonating chamber. So it makes the call expands, you know, makes the call louder. And then when they're sitting like this, they'll open the treetops, and the males form calling centers. Well, they all gather in one spot, so they all call together to make their songs that much louder to attract the females. So that's that little kind of grayish-white membrane of the timbal. That's the sound-producing organ. So I'll let this guy go now. Well, we'll see. I mean, there's be lots more of these. I mean,
the male creates kind of a plug inside her, prevents her from mating again. But the males can mate over and over again. So they're always looking for more mates. The females is just once, usually.
Ethan!
Wow!
Stop! Stop!
A lot of sound was cut over by the during the British occupation during the Revolutionary War, but it's grown back since that time. So it's second growth, but it's still fairly old second growth. Around. So this is one of the shells. This is what they look like when they come out of the ground. So this is what a nymph looks like, and they have these really strong, sharp digging legs. Look like little hooks. And they're going to use those to tunnel upwards out of the ground. And they're pretty strong. Because when I was walking in Buck's Hollow the other day, we were walking on a dirt path that's used by thousands of people every year. And it's really hard-packed dirt. And it was just peppered with exit holes. So these things were able to climb up through this really hard-packed earth, just claw their way through, come out, and then emerge. But they have these really sharp little hook-like claws in the front there. So they're going to come out on any surface, they find any vertical surface, and the back splits open. So you see right there, you can see the slit right there. And then the adult form climbs out. And when they first climb out, you know, they're all white. They're soft and white. And that's when you want to eat them, if you want to eat them. But, I've got a car coming through. Let's just get off to one side. So the back splits open, the adult form comes up, but they're all white. So then they got to spend a little time, they have to pump fluid into their wings to expand them. And then they have to dry out and harden. This takes a few hours. So they do this. Now they're very vulnerable at this time, right? Because they're all soft. So they're going to do this at dusk. They usually come out. We just want to start getting dark, out of the ground, up, climb up into the trees, split out, and then harden up. And then by the next morning, they're usually good to go then. The skin will be hard, the wings will be solid, and they can fly then. But usually it takes a few days after before they actually start singing and becoming really active. So that's a dangerous time for cicadas when they first emerge. They are vulnerable. Now a lot don't even make it out of the shell. They just, for various reasons, they get stuck partway out and they'll just die like that. Sometimes they just start to split open sometimes and something will happen to them. They'll die. Even when they make it out, if it's breezy and the wings get twisted around, that'll kill them then because the wings will dry deformed. They won't be able to fly and they'll just die then. So there's a lot can go wrong between emerging and attaining the adult form. So a lot don't even make it that far. And we'll find some ones a bit later on with a fungus that infects them too. I was finding a number of those down in Wolf Pond. No, one pond. Rather. Yeah. But you see those sharp little claws they have.
When they asked me to remodify the goddamn thing, and I said, I'm not publishing this until I straighten it out. It's a mess. I didn't want the tick, 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 tick.
when they come in the group, do they all try to do it in unison?
Yeah.
All right, we're hearing the rare one right now.
This is good. So, if you listen up here, you hear this kind of ticking sound. Up.
Yeah. That's what we're hearing?
Yeah. That's the rarer one. That's the
almost like a wheel turning.
Like.
Oh man, this is good.
This is the third one on the
list? Yeah, this is the third one on the list.
It's the rare one.
And it's hard to pick out the whole song because you have all the background noise from the other ones.
We've never really heard them chorus though.
No.
Only heard
in Bloomingdale you had kind of a chorus going.
Yeah.
You do have this. So this chalky white stuff you see. There's another one right there. That's a fungus called Massospora cicadina, and it specializes on periodical cicadas. So basically, it's gonna this cicada's abdomen will just become a mass of fungal spores, which will just spread onto the other ones.
And does that kill the cicadas?
It kills them. It kills them. Yeah. Although it's still enough survive to carry on, but this is a specialized predator, if you want to call a fungus a predator.
Does that only come out every 17 years also?
Yeah, the spores are kind of dormant in the soil, and then when the cicadas start emerging, they activate and they attack the cicadas. And this one is still alive, even though its abdomen is mostly fungal spores now. But it'll live a little bit longer and it'll die. Of course, they cannot reproduce in this manner because their reproductive organs are gone. But that is a big killer of cicadas. Besides, you know, everything eating them, they have to deal with this too. The fungus.
Is that fungus only for that brood?
Yeah, it's only for us periodical cicadas. Yeah. So it's a real specialized thing, a real specialized organism.
What about poison ivy?
Doesn't bother them.
No?
No.
Okay.
I see them all over the poison ivy.
Is the fungus common? Does it kill a lot of them?
Yeah, I think it does kill quite a few, because I've found a number of them this morning in the other place that have the fungus, but there's still millions left over. No matter how many get eaten or get killed, there's still millions left.
There's a machine, I already found out a lot.
Okay, so we're continuing our search.
It's like ice cream. Is your idea of making like an ATM? What do you mean? Like we don't like pull someone out of this?
No. So avoid it.
I did not know it was poison.
Don't touch
trees.
It.
Oh, it's a vine. You can see it all along the trees.
It goes as a vine all day. Up the trees and everything, but this you should recognize. It's going all up this tree, all over the place. This is all down here, too.
That's also poison ivy?
Some is, yeah, some isn't. Yeah. See, it has three leaves.
Yeah, the three leaves.
Mostly is not, but then it can be mixed in, like.
Yeah, you might not see it.
Yeah, it just because it looks very similar. This is mostly not poison ivy.
Ah, so now I know what it looks like properly.
It's eastern wood peewee. It's a type of flycatcher, a little gray bird out like that.
Oh, you need to buy it. And then bear right. It'll swing right.
Yeah. You hear them?
Are you hearing it?
Yeah, you hear it?
Yeah.
Well, up here.
Yep.
What's it supposed to sound like that?
Together. But that's them. That's the rare one. I'm surprised to get here.
We haven't heard the second one, though.
No,
yet?
I haven't heard Cassini yet. The second one. That got a different sound.
And that bird's
concentrated bunch right here.
And all the holes we're seeing, those are their exit holes.
I hadn't noticed, but...
Oh, yeah, there were a lot of, like...
Yeah, about dime-sized holes. Yeah, those would be exit holes.
There were
roots from the trees would be underneath.
Yeah, somewhere. Yeah, there's all kinds of roots underneath there. Listen to that. That's a pretty good chorus.
That's how I had it at Blue Heron the day I was there, and then you guys came, and the cast and I moved in and drowned them out.
Yeah. That's good though. It's good to hear all three, not all three, but that the rarer species we're hearing right now. The Septendecula. That's a good one. But that's really a southern species. We don't really get, they're not really found far north, so probably about as far north as you're going to get them around here.
That's not it.
These ferns are planted. These aren't native ferns.
Really?
This is, I think, ostrich fern. They get huge.
How would they be planted here? Just by animals?
Oh, no, people put them here.
Okay.
Yeah, but there's a little colony of them here.
Yeah.
Berries later on in the summer, they call ink berries.
Okay.
That stain everything, and if you eat too many, they make you sick. It says it at a tulip tree. So depending on time, you can go walk the pond real quick and then go back up to the stone house from there.
I just want to kind of gather people here. They're kind of sprung out along the trail and let them catch up.
Eli, убери руки с глаз. Вау, Eli, смотри, сколько много ты видишь.
So they like this little sapling squeak gum for some reason, so you got a bunch of them emerge on that.
Are these annuals?
These are all periodical.
Periodical. Yeah. So 16, I guess?
17. And Museum of Zoology. They have a special periodical cicada page.
And if you're really good, you can practice with your annuals. The annual calls.
Yes.
So like,
Irv, what are you doing over there? You're tilting us over.
They're called blue dashers. They perch, and usually perch at the end of twigs or on
what is this pond called?
It's Walker Pond.
Walker Pond. What type of a plant is it?
Yeah, mostly water lilies.
A water lily.
And there's some swamp blue stripe out there, too. But it's mostly water lily. I know. I think we're getting dangerously close to the water.
It's like the Titanic.
It's
And the kid was shocked. He was terrified. He was coming close for the rest of his life.
Which way? To the left?
Actually, this might take us up to Roseville there, but that's good for far.
To the left. It's okay.
There's a lot of tomatoes.
No. No kale.
All right, we gotta get off. Do you see where we're going? How can I carry you there?
Ethan, you're gonna hit your head. We're trying. Well, we clearly can't because.
Need help?
Sí, mi corazón está muy en el parque. ¿Te gusta? ¿Te gusta? ¿Tienes algo en el zapato?
Okay, go, Ethan. Go. Nothing's gonna happen. Go, buddy.
We got poison ivy all over the place.
Three leaves, count them, 1, 2, 3.
Three leaves.
I think I got touched by poison ivy.
You made it.
I made it, yeah.
look at the tuna ride.
She's having trouble flying. I figure I'll find her mate.
Here we go.
She didn't like them.
Approaches his fence by a foot or two, nobody will notice.
They're good pests.
Yeah, they're great. I fed him a cicada because it died. Like, I kept it in the room in the, you know, the butterfly net.
Right.
So thank you all for coming out.
Thank you.
Yeah, for the interest in cicadas. So we always like to see that. At the Staten Island Museum, because we always get excited about cicadas, especially the periodical ones. That's we're basically the museum of cicadas built through the work of our founder William T. Davis, one of the big experts in the early part of the 20th century. We have, as I may have said this earlier, we have the largest cicada collection in North America at the museum, and the second largest in the world. And if you haven't seen our exhibit, you should come down and see that. It's called "They're Back: The Return of the 17-Year Cicadas." It's going to be up for about a year to give us a break while we're preparing new exhibits for Snug Harbor, for the museum over there. So it'll be up for a while, but you should all come in and see that. There's lots more cicada stuff there. See lots of specimens on display. There's videos of the last great cicada walk 17 years ago. And you'll see a baby being carried around in a little backpack. That's him. Yes, he was born in a cicada year, so he was 3 months old during the last cicada walk. Then you'll see my wife Leslie is there carrying him around.
With brown hair.
Then you'll see me here with long hair and a ponytail. So things have changed in 17 years. But it's a good little video that CNN made back then. They walked around with us. And we have it all showing in the gallery. There's also a nice video made at the University of Indiana back in, I think, 2004 during that emergence out there. And it's really good. It's really excellent photography. You get the whole thing from start. We have the short version. It's about 5 minutes. We get the whole from start to finish. So it's really good. So I think it's been posted online too, but we have it shown continuously at the museum. So by all means, stop down. You can get your limited edition cicada t-shirts with 2013 on them. Ray has the one from 1996. So super limited edition, no longer available, out of print.
Collector's item.
Yeah, a true collector's item.
And this is the Staten Island Museum?
Yes, down in St. George.
I'm
trying to get
more.
Do you have one on you?
Yes, two.
At the University of Indiana.
Let me get a picture with my macro lens.
They have one on DVD. They give them away for free. They have so many of them. They just give them away. I think it was a 2004 emergence, or it could have been 2008. It was either blue.
Wow, that sounds pretty
realistic. I thought it was a
Thank you.
See you later, Ed. Oh, great. Oh, sorry. Good. I like that. From the GSA.
You take pictures of rocks.
I know, that's good.
And the scale. And you got the grain size.
That's good. So, I like the up-to-date geologic time scale, too.
Yeah, I bought a bunch of these from the GSA to give them out.
Great. Thank you.
I'm going to give one to you for each show.
Thank you.
Okay.
This concludes our walk. I hope you enjoyed it.
Yeah, well done.
Thank you.
I'll see you all back here in 17 years.
Yeah.
Oh.
Let's see, in 17 years, I'll be 84.
I'll be 76, so we can help each other over the trails.
It's by the other people. You see, it's the energy.